Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning. It's good to see everybody here today at church. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Congratulations, you made it. It's 2021. Hope you guys had a wonderful Christmas, too. My name is John. I have the privilege of serving as the campus pastor here, and we're just so glad that you joined us here for worship. Melissa and I, we had a great Christmas. We were able to see some family back in Tennessee. And we got to officiate a former student of ours at Kentucky's wedding. We have a photo of the wedding this past Friday. And we got back last night at 7 o'clock p.m. to a full driveway of snow. And it's good to be back. And when we go and leave and go back home, we go back and see old friends from different places. We just can't stop talking about you guys. We just love it here. We love you guys. There's no other place that we would rather be. Father God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you that it is ultimate truth and that it comforts and strengthens our hearts. God, not only were these words that the Apostle Peter wrote thousands of years ago true, but they are true today. So God, we claim what you have done for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. It's our hope. And God, just thank you that we get to be here this morning. So I ask right now, God, that you do what I cannot do, and that's transform hearts. So Holy Spirit, will you be here today? Will you be present and move where you need to move? In Christ's name we pray. Everybody said, amen. As you guys can see, we have just a wonderful text this morning, full of hope, full of encouragement. I want to start out with this question. Have you ever received some sort of encouragement just in the right time? Have you ever received encouragement, some sort of encouragement at the right time? Maybe you were heading into a difficult week. You knew it was going to be tough. You were already just a little bit stressed, a little bit anxiety. Maybe you were heading into an interview, a job interview, maybe a college interview. Maybe it was perhaps a crisis situation. Maybe you got that phone call from the doctor, and he gave you the news of the diagnosis. Maybe it was for you or a loved one, or maybe someone passed. But that phone call, or maybe it was a text, or maybe it was a card in the mail, or maybe someone even showed up at your door and knocked at your door and gave you some encouragement, and it strengthened your heart just in time. This is the heart of what Peter is writing in his letter to these Christians. So a little context and a little overview of the book of 1 Peter. Peter's writing to Christians that are suffering for their faith, severe persecution. And Peter writes to them to strengthen and encourage their hearts in the midst of these things. See, these Christians, they have been forced out of their homes. They've been forced out of what they knew, what was familiar, and they were scattered over five Roman provinces, which today is modern Turkey. And so as you can imagine, these Christians, they have lost possessions. They lost family. They lost their friends. They're not able to meet together as a church. And they're facing all this, and they're trying to navigate how to live in a hostile world, how to live in a world that is no longer for them because of their faith in Jesus Christ. Now, this is the same Peter, the author, that walked with Jesus, that was called out by Jesus to be a fisherman, that knew Jesus. And by the way, I just think it's incredible that we have a letter from someone that walked and knew Jesus. Isn't that just kind of crazy? I think sometimes we just lose the awe of the Word of God. Jesus knew and walked. Peter walked and knew Jesus. And this is the same Peter that would say bold things, who kind of had a roller coaster life and often put his foot in his mouth, right? This is the same Peter that would say like amazing things. Like he's the first one to confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. But then like literally the next verses, Peter says something silly and Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan." Be like, "Oh, that's who I am now. Okay, you know." Peter, he denies Jesus Christ, but then Jesus says, "You're going to be this great church leader." And that's who Peter was, and that's what he became. Peter becomes a great church leader. And in 1 Peter, we see Peter's pastoral heart. We see his heart for Christians that are suffering. And Peter honestly gets a bad rap for his bold statements, the silly things he would say and do. But we can't deny that Peter loved Jesus. He loved him so much, and he wanted to please him, and he wanted to worship him. And when Peter ran to that grave and saw that it was empty, and when he saw Jesus for the first time face to face, from that moment, everything changed for Peter. Everything changed. And he could not deny Jesus from then. And so his pastoral heart here in 1 Peter, he's reminding them that they belong to God no matter what their circumstances are, and that no hardship, no persecution can ever, ever take away the hope that they have. Isn't that good news? That nothing can take away, nothing can separate us from God. So here's where it might hit us today. It might hit you today. You might be facing persecution for your faith. I don't know. Maybe you are. Or maybe you've come here today with grief, struggling with depression, anxiety, loss of some sort. What Peter is saying to the Christians and what is still true for us today is that what we experience here on earth is not our ultimate final experience, because we have a hope. We have an inheritance that is guaranteed. That is guaranteed because Jesus rose from the grave. And that's a living hope that we possess as believers. And so this morning's message, if you're taking notes, this message is called, "We Should Always Thank the Heavenly Father for the Hope of Eternal Life in Christ." We should always thank the Heavenly Father for the hope of eternal life in Christ. So this morning, I have 3 points. And the first one is this. I have hope because of the means of my salvation. Bless the Lord. Look at verse 3 again. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again." So here's what Peter does. This is the opening of this letter. Peter's audience, they didn't open a book like we're opening the Bible and turn to page in my Bible. It's page 1015, okay? They opened a scroll. And so this would be one of the first things they would see. And Peter, right off the bat, he starts with praise and worship. What an amazing way to start off a letter, right? Praise and worship to God. Because here is what Peter wants to communicate right off the bat, that there is no suffering, no hardship, no trial too big for us that we can't worship God. There's no circumstance, there's no trial, there's no hardship too big, too large, that we can't lift up Jesus Christ. You see, church, this is what happens. When we go through a trial, when we go through suffering, when something is heavy on our hearts, we can praise God. And here's how we do it. We elevate God above our circumstances. That's what worship is. Elevating God above our circumstances. So how does this work? Like, how do we elevate God above all the circumstances that you and I face in this life? What's this? It's by recalling God's promises that he's given to us. It's remembering his power, his sovereignty over all things. And the last P, we remember his presence. That his presence is with us. It never leaves us. And even when we go through the trial, and even when we're going through hardships, God never leaves us. His power, his presence, and his promises. And so personally, for me, when I need to be reminded of this, my go-to passage, I highly recommend it, is Psalm 46. It's Psalm 46. Maybe look at it a different time. It talks about how God is our refuge, our strength, our provider, our helper. And then what it says finally at the end, it says, "Be still and know that I am God." Be still and know I am God. That helps me. And maybe it's an encouragement to you to recall and worship and elevate God over our circumstances. So let me ask you this question. What is your go-to passage? What is your go-to scripture when you're in the midst of hardships and trials? Where do you run to? Do you run to God or do you run from God? Do you try to find the quick solution or do you just remember and be a son and daughter of God who loves you, who is for you, and that is with you? I encourage you to find scripture for those times. And listen, I'm not suggesting that God's the Word of God is a self-help book. That's not what it is. But what I am suggesting is that God is our help, and He is present, and He's there in the midst of hardships and troubles. Peter also starts with worship to remind them that it's by God's mercy that we are saved and that we have this hope. He says it's according to His great mercy that He has caused us to be born again. And God's great mercy is how we are saved. Notice Peter doesn't say, it's by you, John, when you walked up, you know, in eighth grade down the aisle, that's how you were saved. No, it's by God's mercy. And this is what mercy means. Mercy means that God has looked down on us. He's looked down on you and I as sinful people, as sinners, and He's given us compassion and kindness and love and has given us not what we deserved. That's what mercy is. None of us deserve it. None of us, frankly, deserve anything good from God. But God does that because He's merciful. And that's the start of salvation. It's by His mercy that Peter says that we are born into a living hope. We are born again. Born again meaning new life, a brand new start, a fresh beginning. And that happens the moment that you receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. I don't know when that time was for you, but that's when you were born again. That's when your salvation started. When God, wherever you were, was me, I was at a college camp, didn't care about God at all, but I heard the gospel message and I went down forward. That's when I was born again. If you've had that moment, you have a living hope, and it's by God's mercy. And if you don't have that hope, I just want to tell you this morning, it's available. It's available. It's free. It doesn't cost you anything. It costs Jesus everything. It's worth it. You can have it right now. You can have that hope and salvation right now. It's by God's mercy. The second point this morning, if you're taking notes, we have hope not only because of the mean of our salvation. But secondly, we have hope because of the results of our salvation. Bless the Lord. Verse 3, according to His great mercy, God has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Peter says that the results of God's mercy is this great salvation and living hope that we possess. Now, let's talk about hope just for a second. The hope that Peter is talking about is not the hope that you and I talk about and use all the time. It's not a positive desire, a strong desire or longing for something to happen that might. Okay, you guys tracking? That's how we use the word hope. Like today, like, man, I hope we have tacos for lunch. I hope the Bears win today, and I heard that they can make the playoffs if they win today. It's crazy. I hope they win today. Or I hope 2021 is better than 2020. Even if those things have great odds, right? It's not certain. It's not guaranteed. It's not promised to happen. That's not the hope that Peter is talking about. It's a way different hope. It's a hope that is guaranteed. It's a hope that is certain. It's a hope that is going to happen no matter what happens. And let me just tell you this, if 2020, I've learned a lot in 2020, I'm guessing you have too. I've learned a lot of lessons. But one lesson that I've learned over and over is that everything in this world is uncertain and insecure. I cannot place my hope in anything. And we can't because it's not promised. It's not guaranteed. Like job security, it's not certain. Health is not certain. Finances. The stock market is not certain. Relationships, tragically, are not certain. Even the rhythms of life that we knew pre-COVID, that we were depending on, it can all be taken away. All these things can be taken away just like that, in the snap of a finger. And this can be incredibly disorienting, right? It can be hard, especially when it's sudden. But what this does is that reminds us, church, that there's only one true living hope. There's only one thing that is secure. There's only one thing that's guaranteed, and that's the living hope that we possess as believers. Amen? Amen. And this is the hope that Peter talks about. This is the biblical hope that's sure, that's steadfast, that's 100% guaranteed to happen. You guys want to know why it's guaranteed to happen? Because Jesus is alive. Because Jesus is no longer dead in the grave. That's why Peter calls it a living hope. He could have just said hope, and we would have got it. But he says a living hope because I believe with all my heart, Peter says when he's writing this letter, he wants to say, I'm going to put emphasis on this and call it a living hope because I was an eyewitness to that empty tomb, to that empty grave. I saw Jesus face to face after his resurrection. I walked with him. I ate with him. And I have this living hope. And this is what Peter is doing. He's trying to strengthen and encourage these Christians. And that's, I don't know if you can tell, that's what I'm trying to do to you through God's word is strengthen your heart and encourage your heart that no matter what you face in this life, you have a living hope that's guaranteed because there's an empty grave. And I'm sure on that Friday and Saturday before Jesus rose from the grave that it felt hopeless, that it felt like that Jesus' followers and Christians just took a big L and that it was over. But I guarantee when Jesus arose from the grave, when breath filled his lungs, that they didn't feel hopeless anymore. And guess what? You don't have to either, Christian. You don't have to either, believer, because Jesus is not in the grave. He's alive and well, and he's preparing a place for us. We have a living hope. It gets better. Peter describes this living hope. Look back in your Bibles. As an inheritance that is imperishable, meaning it won't die, it lasts forever, undefiled, meaning it won't lose its purity, and unfading, meaning unlike anything else in this world, it's not going to rust, rot, be destroyed or stolen, or fade, or it won't become boring or less joyful, kept in heaven for you. We have an inheritance that won't become imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. So the question is, church, what is this inheritance? What is our living hope that the Apostle Peter is excited about, that he just worshiped God about from the get-go? What is our living hope? Well, there's two things. You can write these down in your notes. The first one is this: finally being in the presence of God. It's being with Jesus face to face. It's our final deliverance. It's our faith that finally has become sight. It's seeing the one who we followed, who we trusted, who we lean into, who we abided with, the one that we looked to as an older brother, as an example, when life was hard, and when we trusted him, even when we didn't want to trust, even we didn't know what God was doing in our lives, even though we know that he was working, we still followed him. The one who was victorious over the grave, the one who saved us, the one who overcame everything so that you and I, as John 16 says, could overcome. The first is being in the presence of God, being with Jesus face to face. I don't know about you, but is anybody excited about that day, one day, just being with Jesus? I mean, come on, like, great. Secondly, it's deliverance from this broken world. It's also our living hope in our inheritance. It's deliverance from this broken world, from the power and the presence of sin, from grief, from pain, death, depression, anxiety. No more protests, no more riots, no more sickness, no more social media drama, no remembering to wear your mask, okay? Like all that, it will be gone. The greatest picture of this, I don't have time to read it, turn later, is Revelation 21, 1 through 5. It's the greatest picture of what the new heavens and the new earth and what is going to be eradicated and then what is going to exist for eternity. That is coming, church. That is coming one day. It's going to for sure happen because Jesus rose from the grave. It's guaranteed. Also, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 that we're going to have new bodies that are going to be exempt from sin and decay. And then also, I'm excited about this. We're going to be restored with the ones that passed before us. Grandfathers, grandmothers, fathers, sons, daughters. We're going to see them again one day. And James describes our life on here on earth as a vapor, but eternity is much longer. It's going to be incredible. That is our inheritance. Our hope, church, is alive because Jesus is alive. And because Jesus rose, he's going to raise us up one day too. We don't have to fear death because listen to this. Death is just a doorway to our inheritance. You understand that? We don't have to fear death. It's a doorway to Jesus and our inheritance one day. Paul says to live is Christ and to die is gain. Why? Because finally we'll see Jesus and be delivered. I heard a pastor say it like this about Jesus' resurrection and how we'll be raised one day too. That Jesus' resurrection was God's pledge for our future resurrection. Jesus' resurrection was God's pledge for our future resurrection. And Paul says this, he reaffirms this in Ephesians 2, the great first 10 verses in Ephesians 2 that talks about how we were dead in sin, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, says that he made us alive together in Christ. It's by grace you have been saved. And here it is, ready? And raised us up and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ. Paul, in verse 6, talks about our future hope in the past tense. Why does he talk about our future hope in the past tense? I don't know about you guys, but I don't feel like I'm seated in the heavenly with Christ. I'm for sure not with Jesus, like, right now. Like, he's here, but we're not there yet. You understand? So why does Paul talk about this in the past tense? Here's why. Because it is as good as done because of Jesus' resurrection. Because Jesus rose from the dead, it's as if Paul is saying, you're right there with him right now. Because that's what God is going to do to us. Hold on to faith, because one day, our great inheritance is coming. And Paul says, or Peter says, that our inheritance is kept in heaven. Kept in heaven. That word kept means to be reserved or set aside. So to illustrate this, Melissa and I, we just celebrated our fourth year wedding anniversary. And during our wedding planning 4.5 years ago, we did like one of those fast engagements, like 3 months. Like, it was fast, maybe a little too quick, but hey, we're here, we're married, okay? Well, it is what it is. She married me. I don't care what happened during that, okay? So I feel like I won the lottery, okay? So during our wedding planning, if you've gone through it, you know what happens. You're not stressed at all, right? And there's no stress. So we did the whole thing where we picked out our colors, or she did, and I said yes on it, you know? And we picked out, like, she got her dress. Obviously, I wasn't there. And we landed on the suits for myself and our groomsmen, okay? And so my parents graciously paid for my suit. I actually have it here. I'm not going to put it on, obviously. But this is, like, my wedding suit that I wore for our wedding, okay? And so if you've ever had to get a suit, I've had to get a suit twice in my life, this wedding being one of them. I went to the store, and they're like, what's your name? What's the occasion? And like, I'm getting married. And they're like, congratulations, win the date. And you have to tell the story again, okay? And then they said, well, let's get you fitted into the suit that you've chosen. So I got fitted. And they said, well, Mr. Bell, we need to get it tailored for you. You can come back and get it. Okay? And I said, okay. So I went back and I went to the store and said, hey, my name's John and I'm here to pick up my wedding suit. They said, well, Mr. Bell, we have kept it nice and safe and secure for you. I said, that's awesome. I didn't know that never thought they'd go that far for a wedding suit. Anyway, okay, so new experience for me. So I go, and sure enough, they go into the front of the store where the counter was, and they unlock this cabinet, and there was my suit. And it was in this bag, and they said, Mr. Bell, we want to let you know that no one was able to come pick up your suit but you. It has your name on it. We put it in this bag so that no dust, no dirt, we get on it. It's been kept nicely for you, and it's ready for you to put on right now if your wedding was in 10 minutes. I said, thank you very much. Shook her hands. This was obviously pre-COVID, you know? And so I put it on for a wedding, and it was great. So why do I give you that illustration? Because this is what God has done for you and I, if you're in Christ. Jesus has paid for your salvation fully. You don't have to do anything but believe and have faith. And you have an inheritance that's being kept for you that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. And it's yours. It's kept for you. So keep running your race. Keep holding on to faith. Don't lose heart. Dawn is coming. Jesus is coming back for us. Don't lose heart. Finally, this morning, we can have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. Bless the Lord. We can have hope because of the permanence of our salvation. Bless the Lord. In verse 5, it says this, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Not only, church, are we saved by God's great mercy into an inheritance that's kept in heaven for us, but we are being kept for it. Not only do we have this incredible inheritance that's being kept for us, but listen, you and I are being kept for it. And Peter uses the word guarded strategically. This word guarded is a military term that means to be shielded, protected, secured, to be watched over. So this week, I looked up the most secure, protected places in the world. And the unanimous number one choice was the United States Bullion Depository, located in Fort Knox, Kentucky. Let me tell you a little bit about this place, Fort Knox, okay? The depository is fortified with vaults that house 147.3 million ounces of gold. It's a big number. I don't know what that translated, so I looked up more. It equals about $168 billion. Chump change, okay? So $168 billion. And I read to find out that it's not only surrounded by electric fences, landmines, laser-triggered machine guns, whatever that is, and 40,000 soldiers, but the vault doors that go into the vault where all this gold is being housed, the door weighs 20 tons and measures 22 inches thick. The vault is bomb-proof. It has 16,000 cubic feet of granite with 1,300 tons of steel. No person, not one person, knows the combination to the vault. Supposedly, it's divvied up between 15 and 25 different people. Obviously, you're not allowed to go as a visitor to this place. And this is also what I found out, that no one has successfully broken into this vault. I would hope not, with all the secure and protocols, right? But listen, do you know who is more secure? You know who is more secure than even Fort Knox? It's us, believers, chosen ones, those who have salvation in Jesus Christ. God is guarding us. He's keeping you secure. And how is he doing this, church? How is he keeping you secure? How do you know he's keeping you secure? Well, I would have loved if Peter would have said, you know, God's keeping you. He's guarding you by keeping away from trials and sufferings. I wish that it might have said that. But we know that God's not guarding us from death because we still pass away. People still pass, right? What does Peter say? Look back in the text. It says this, that God guards us through faith. He guards us through faith. How does this work? Here's how it works. He keeps us from unbelief. He keeps you and I from unbelief. He keeps our faith alive. And here's how this works out. Here's how this works out. In my life, just being honest with you, there's been times in my Christian walk where I've been tempted to believe that God isn't for me, that God isn't with me, that the barrier of the mountain is too big or too high to cross. Or I've looked at my life and what's going on, the circumstances, and just said, God, what are you doing? I don't feel you. I don't hear from you like I used to. But for some reason, I didn't give up. For some reason, I held on. And maybe that's your story too. There's been times in crisis in your life where you've wanted to give in and throw the towel in and not go to church, not go to small group, not serve, not pray, not read. But for some reason, you just can't give up and fully unbelieve in Christ. And here's the thing. It actually wasn't you holding on to God. It was God holding on to you. You know why? because God guards his children from unbelief, because we have an inheritance, church, that's being kept for us, a living hope that's being kept for us. God is holding on to you, and Peter wants his audience to know that they are secure, and he doesn't want to leave them without wondering if they have any hope. Because here's the thought. Here's the thought of what Peter is saying in this, in these first five verses of this chapter. If God, by his mercy, has caused us to be born again, if God has caused us to be born again into an inheritance that's being kept for us, if he sent Jesus Christ on the cross to save us from our sins, does God just sit back and say, I hope John makes it. I hope he endures. I hope he can get through this crisis. I hope he makes it to salvation. I'm crossing my fingers. I have all these great, great things waiting for him. I hope he makes it to the end. No, it's not who our God is. That's not what the Bible, and that's not what Peter paints of the character of God. The character of God is Philippians 1:6, that he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it upon the day of Jesus Christ. And notice that it says, God will do it. Because listen, it doesn't solely depend on you. It depends on God. It depends on him. So when you feel like giving up, church, when you feel like throwing in the towel, when you feel like all hope is lost, when you're down and out, remember this, God is keeping you. It doesn't mean that you're gonna live this perfect Christian life. It doesn't mean that we're gonna be without trials and sufferings. I mean, Peter's audience is going through it right now. But Peter and God want you and I to know, even 2,000 years later, that you have an inheritance being kept for you, and you are being kept for it. Isn't that good news? Isn't that great news? It's hard to believe. It's hard to believe. There's nothing like it. So today, maybe you've never trusted Christ for your salvation. You can have this hope. It can be yours. We'd love to talk to you about it after the service, if that's you. Come as you are. Come as you are. Maybe today, start the new year, you need a plan. You're like, Pastor John, I need a plan. Like, I want to get some hope in my life. I need support. I need care. I need some encouragement. Well, I just happen to have some things in my notes to maybe help you. Pastor Jake talked about it today. We're starting these online free hope classes where you can have hope in your marriage, in your finances, hope at home, depression maybe, anxiety. We're offering that. It starts this week. You get all the info at harvestnow.info. Our church is starting a Bible reading plan. You can go to harvestnow.info to join that plan. I'm going to join it because I want to be in God's word with our church, with you. And do this together. And this February, like in a month away, I'm really excited about this. We are starting a marriage ministry here at our campus. And I'm really excited about this because I've heard in COVID, and even Melissa and I, if we're just being honest here in front of you, being transparent, we have felt just a little bit more pressure, a little bit more hardships in our marriage because of COVID. And we want to be with our campus and learn how to pursue Christ in this marriage life that he has for us, but also to enjoy marriage. God created marriage, right? It's a good thing. He wants us to enjoy it. It's a picture of Christ in the church. And we want to lean in with you to do this. And so we have some friends in Kentucky that have this amazing thing called Grace Marriage. It's coaching. It's every 90 days. And we're going to have it at our campus and online. And you'll be hearing more about it soon. But I'm really excited that's going to come. If you need hope in your marriage, this will be available to you. And finally this morning, if you are a believer, if you are a Christian, you have this hope. Here's what we should be doing as Christians. This should just be overflowing from our lives. But we need to tell people about the hope that lies in Jesus Christ. We need to be telling people, one of our campus pastors, Dave Lernon, says this, because we are Christians, we should be hope dealers. You like that? We should be hope dealers. Why? Because we have this incredible hope that's never going to fade or perish. And we should be telling the world this. And listen, our world needs to hear the hope of the gospel right now. Right now, they need to hear it. And here's why. Not only, church, are we experiencing a global pandemic, But we're also experiencing a mental health and economical pandemic too. Check this out. Mental health right now is at an all-time low. In the last 9 months, calls to the mental health hotline has increased by 1,000%. 1,000%. Normally, one out of every five Americans suffer from mental health. In the last 9 months, it's one out of every three. Online therapy has jumped 65% since February. Let's talk about frontline workers who are some incredible people. They're experiencing a 45% increase of anxiety, and 34% are suffering from insomnia. Unemployment rates have risen 20%, and suicide could raise to an all-time high in 2 months from now. Now listen, a stimulus bill, a vaccine, new job opportunities, stores and restaurants reopening, those are all going to be great things and it'll be helpful to people's health. But that's not the ultimate fix. It's not the ultimate fix. What the human heart needs is the hope of the gospel, the hope that only Jesus Christ can offer that is 100% guaranteed, the eternal hope that Jesus Christ offers. So let's love, let's support these people that are suffering. Maybe it's you today. We love you. We're so glad you came to church. But let's tell this broken world that is suffering that they have a hope that they can look forward to like we do, that they can have joy and peace that surpasses all understanding because of what God has done in our lives by His great mercy. So as I close, let's stand up. I think the appropriate response this morning, church, is worship, because we, through God's mercy, have been born into a living hope that is going to last forever, an inheritance being kept for us, and we are being kept for it. So receive this morning, church, God's love for you in the Word, in your heart, in your life, because you are chosen, loved, and secured. So let's right now, church, let's bless the Lord with all we got. Amen.